Hi, welcome to Coding Droplets. In this video, we are going to create a simple ASP.NET Web API microservice which uses MySQL database to save the data. We are currently developing a demo microservice solution in which there are multiple microservices which uses different databases. So first, let me give you an overview of the solution which we are creating. We have already created the customer service which uses SQL Server database. This service is only having the customer module in it. Now, in this video, we are developing the second service named product service, which uses MySQL database. So this microservice will only be having the product module in it. You can also include submodules related to product module like product category, product brands, manufacturer, etc. But for demo purpose, I'm only creating product module now. In the next video, we'll create another microservice named order service, which uses MongoDB database. That module will be handling the orders of different customers, which includes the products they ordered, the quantity of each products in the order, etc. After that, we'll create an API gateway, which will route the API requests to these three services. Then finally, we'll create a web application which only communicate with the API gateway. From the application, we'll be able to create customers, products, and orders. We'll be able to do the CRUD operations in all the modules from the web application. CRUD means create, read, update, and delete. In this video, we'll also add container orchestrator support for the new service which we are going to create and configure the Docker Compose YAML file. So before starting, you should know a few things. This video is part of a series named Microservice Architecture. You can find the playlist link in the video description to watch the other videos in this series. So now let's start developing the .NET Core Web API with MySQL database. I have opened the demo microservice solution which we have created in our last video. In the Solution Explorer, you can see the solution folder named Microservices, and inside that we have the Customer Web API. Also, we have the Docker Compose project which will get created while adding the Docker Orchestrator support. Now, inside Microservice folder, I'm creating a new project. Let me select ASP.NET Core Web API project template and click on Next button. Let the project name be Product Web API, then clicking Next button again. As done in the previous video, I'm choosing .NET 6 framework. Then unchecking the configure for HTTPS checkbox, also unchecking the Open API support. You can enable this if you need Swagger. Now the project got created, let's remove weather forecast controller and weather forecast CS files. Those are the demo files created by Visual Studio, we don't need them. For database read-write operations, I'm making use of Entity Framework Core library. So let me install that from Nugget Package Manager. Navigating to Browse tab and searching for mysql.entityframworkcore. The library is listed in the first place. Let me install it. It is installed now. We can see the library now in the installed tab. Next, we can create the model class for our entity. So let me create a folder named models inside the project. Now let me add a new class inside the models folder and let me name it as product. The first property we need in the product entity is the product ID, which is the unique ID for the entity. The data type is integer. Next property is product name, which is string data type. Then we can also include product code. Let it be also string data type. Finally, product price, which is of decimal data type. Next, we can add some attributes that we can use in entity framework. Let me add table attribute for the product class. We can provide a custom table name along with this attribute. So the table name will be product in lowercase. I'm also providing key attribute for the product ID to denote that it is the primary key. Also, I'm providing a custom column name for product ID. Let me also provide custom column names for other properties as well. Product underscore name, product underscore code, and product underscore price, completely in lowercase. Next, let's create the database context class. Let me name it as product DB context. This class should be inherited from DB context class of entity framework. Now I'm creating a constructor for this class. We can provide DB context options as the constructor parameter and call the base class constructor by passing the DB context options object to it. Inside the constructor, I'm creating a try-catch method. If any error occurs, I'm just writing the error message in the console window. Now inside the try method, let me create an object for database creator. Then just verifying the database creator object is not null. Now using this object, I'm creating the database if it doesn't exist. Then creating tables if there are no tables in the database. Next, we can declare the DB set for the product entity. Let the name be products. So now the database context class is ready. Next, we can add the dependency injection. Let me open program.cs from the Solution Explorer. Here we are going to add the database context dependency injection. Initially, I'm hard coding some values. We'll change it while configuring the Docker Compose. Let the DB host be localhost. Then DB name be DMS_product. Also, let me hard code the DB password. Now let me add the dependency injection builder.services.addDBContext of product_db_context, then o such that o.useMySQL. We need to pass the connection string as a parameter here. Let's create a connection string using the hard-coded values in it. Now we can provide this connection string as a parameter for useMySQL method. Next, we can create an API controller inside the controllers folder. Choosing API from the left side menu and selecting empty API controller template. Let's name it as product controller. First, let me create a constructor for this class and providing product DB context as a parameter. As we have done the dependency injection, we can receive the product DB context object as a parameter here. Let me also declare a private read-only product DB context object and assign the received object to it. Now we can create the API methods. First, let me create HTTP GET method with the name getProducts, which returns all the products. Inside the method, we can just return dbContext.products. It will return all the products in our database table. Next method is HTTP GET method, which accepts the product ID along with the URL. The method name is getByID. This method is for returning the product details of the product with the provided ID. In the method, we can fetch the product using findAsync method and pass the product ID as the parameter. Then we can just return the product object. Next is a HTTP POST method for creating a new product. This method accepts the product object as a parameter, will pass the product details as the request body in JSON format. I am using the addAsync method to add the product. Also, we need to save the changes after adding the product, then just returning an OK response. Next is a HTTP put method to update an existing product. We can use the update method for updating a record. Here also we must save changes after updating it, then just returning an OK response. The final method is HTTP delete for deleting the products. This method also accepts product ID along with the URL. In the method, first we can fetch the product using the provided ID, then calling the remove method to remove the product from the database, then saving the changes and returning an OK response. So that's it needed in the API controller. Now we have the methods to create, read, update, and delete. Now we can test the API methods using Postman. So let me set the new project as the startup project and run it. Now the application is running and you can see that it is listening on port 5197. Let me copy the base URL. Just before testing with Postman, I am opening MySQL Workbench, which is a visual database designing or graphical user interface tool for MySQL. Now there are no databases listed in the schemas section. So let's open Postman and test the API methods. On the left side pane named My Workspace is listing the API methods which we have created in the last video for customer microservice. Let me create a new folder under Demo Microservice Solution and naming it as Product Web API. Now let's add a new request and changing the HTTP method to post. The post method is used to create new products. I'm pasting the base URL here and providing the complete URL of the controller. In our controller, the route attribute is for mentioning the controller URL. It is API/controller name. For the post request, we must pass the product details as the request body in JSON format. Let the product name be product001, then product code be P1. Finally, the value for product price property, let it be 100. Now let's send the request and you can see we received a 200 OK response. That means the API execution is successful. Let's open MySQL Workbench again and check now. I'm just clicking on the refresh button and you can see the database got created now. Inside the database, we have our table named product. Let's list out the table rows and we can see the product details. Let's create one more product by changing the values in our API request body. Again, we got successful response. Let's have a look in MySQL Workbench. So the post request is working fine. Let me save this request in Postman so that we can use it later for testing. Let me name it as create. Now adding another request, let the method be htp get, providing the complete URL of the API controller. Now this should execute the getProducts method and list all the products in our database. Let's try it. We can see both the products which we have added in JSON format. So let me save this request as well with the name getProducts. Let's create the next request for fetching the product details by filtering with the product ID. This method is again htp get, but we should also provide the product ID along with the URL. Now you can see it has only displayed the product details, which is having a product ID of 1. Let me change the product ID to 2 in the URL. And now it is showing the second product. Saving this request as well with the name getByID. Now another request to update the product details. So the method should be http put, then providing the URL. For this method, also we must provide the product details in the request body. Let me copy the request body from the post request. But here, we also need to provide the product ID. It will update the product which matches the provided product ID. Let's make some changes in the product details. Now clicking on the send button and we received the successful response. Let's check in MySQL Workbench. I'm just executing the select query again and you can see the product details got updated. Let me save this request with the name update. Now the final request for deleting the product, the method should be httpdelete. For this request also, we must provide the product ID along with the URL, the product ID of the product to be deleted. I'm providing product ID 1. Now let's see whether it is deleted or not. It got deleted successfully, so all the methods are working fine. Let me save this request with the name delete. Next, we are going to add container orchestrator support for this project as well. Just before adding that, let's open current Docker Compose YAML file. We have done this configuration for customer microservice in our last video. To add container orchestrator support, we can right-click on the project, then go to add option. There we have container orchestrator support. Selecting Docker Compose as container orchestrator and Linux as the container operating system. Now a new Docker file got added in our project, but this time instead of creating a new Docker Compose project, Visual Studio added the product API container details in our existing Docker Compose YAML file. You can see a new service named Product Web API. Now let's configure the Docker Compose YAML file as we did before. We are going to add MySQL container as well. First, let me provide a container name for the product API container. Then adding the backend network which we have created in our last video. This container will be also under the same network. Next, let me assign a port number. I am providing 8004 for port 80. The application will be listening on port 80 in the container. Now we can provide some environment variables for constructing the connection string as we did for SQL Server. The DB host is product DB. We'll create a new service for MySQL with the same name. Then providing DB name, let it be DMS underscore product. Then the password, you can assign a different password if you need, but let it be the same for this demo. I'm also changing the DB name of the previous customer database. Let it be DMS underscore customer. Now we can add a new service for MySQL. So providing the same name what we have given in DB host environment variable. Before providing the other details, let's open MySQL official image documentation in Docker Hub. I'm searching for MySQL and here we have the official image. Let's open it. These are the supported tags of different versions and operating systems. Also, we can assign the root password by providing the environment variable named MySQL underscore root underscore password. We can use the first tag. Let me open Docker file in GitHub by just clicking on it. Here you can see the container will expose port 3306 and 33060. So we can assign port mapping for 3306. That is the default port for MySQL connectivity. Back to our Docker Compose YAML file. First, let's provide a container name. Then the image. The image name is MySQL. We can copy the tag from Docker Hub documentation. Next, we can provide the environment variable for assigning the root password. Then mapping port 8003 for 3306, which is the default port for MySQL. Now we can assign the backend network. This container also should be under the same network. Now let's modify the DB context dependency injection section to use the values in the connection string from the environment variables. So I am using the environment.getEnvironmentVariable method. Let me copy this and modify DB name and password as well. Now we can provide the environment variable names. DB underscore host for DB host. Then DB underscore name for DB name. Finally, the password. Here, I'm changing the name to DB underscore root underscore password. In MySQL, root is the user with complete permissions. So that's it. Now let me build the Docker Compose project to ensure that there are no errors. Build got succeeded. So let's make the Docker Compose project as the startup project and run it. Now Visual Studio is preparing the containers to debug. Now you can see there are four containers running: Customer API, Customer DB, Product API and Product DB. You can see the containers in Docker Desktop as well. But the Product API is using 60065 instead of 8004. I think 8004 is getting used by some other application in my machine. That's not a problem. We can test the Product API by providing 60065 port number. Now in MySQL Workbench, let me connect to the container MySQL service. Let the connection name be Product DB. Port number is 8003. Let me test the connection. It is asking for the password. We can just copy it from the Docker Compose YAML file. The connection is successful, so let me open it now. In schemas section, we don't have any database now. Let's create a product using Postman. We need to change the port number to 60065. Got 200 OK response. Now in MySQL Workbench, we can see the database. The product successfully saved in MySQL container database. Let's also test the getProducts API method by just changing the port number. That is also working fine. So now we have created our second microservice. We'll be creating one more microservice with a MongoDB database in our upcoming video. After that, we'll create an API gateway to communicate with all these microservices. And finally, a web application that performs the CRUD operations. So that's it for this video. Hope you liked it. Please subscribe, like, and share this video. See you all in the next video. Thank you.